So the next we will see the rectifiers with filters. So what is the purpose of rectifier? Rectifier is to convert AC signal into pulsating DC signal. Okay. Rectifier is the device which converts AC signal into pulsating DC signal. Now the pulsating DC signal, if you see the ripple factor, ripple factor shows that how much of the AC content is present in the output of the rectifier. For example, if you take half wave rectifier, the ripple content is 1.21. The ripple factor for full wave rectifier is 0.48. That means the ripple factor should be ideally zero. Then only we can say that there is no AC present in the output. Output is pure DC. So if the ripple factor value is more, okay, then it so shows that the AC content is present in the output, which is not required. Actually, the desirable output is DC. So what we will do is, with the rectifiers, we understood that the AC is completely not eliminated. We will be having some AC plus DC and the ripple factor is high. Okay. Now to eliminate that AC present in the output of the rectifier across the load, then we have to insert a filter which will reduce that AC content and make the ripple factor to be more or less compared when without filter. If you calculate the ripple factor, it was 1.21 and 0.48. By filter, we can reduce further from that 0.48 towards the zero, or 1.21 towards zero. Therefore, the filter is, the purpose of the filter is to reduce the AC content present in the output of the circuit of the rectifier circuit. Okay. Now, where do we insert this filter? Across the load, we will be calculating the output, right? So after the rectifier, if you directly connect the load, you are getting AC. Therefore, what we will do is, after rectifier, we have to connect a filter. Then output of the filter, you have to take it and connect it to the load. Then calculate how much is the AC eliminated because of the filter inserted between rectifier and load. Okay. So we'll see what actually filter is. The output of a half wave or full wave rectifier circuit is not pure DC. Very, very important. It is not pure DC, but it contains fluctuations or ripple which are undesirable. So then generally we are aiming at getting the pure DC. But output of the half wave rectifier or full wave rectifier is not pure DC. It is a pulsating DC. Okay, pulsating DC, nothing but it has got both AC as well as DC. Okay. Which is the AC present in the output is not desirable. So we should eliminate that. The purpose of filter is to eliminate the ripple contents present in the output. So to minimize the ripple content in the output, filter circuits are used. These circuits are connected between the rectifier and load. Okay, because I want after rectifier, some AC is there. To eliminate that, after rectifier, you connect a filter before connecting the load. So the filter will come in between rectifier and load. Now, ideally, the output of the filter should be pure DC. Okay, ideally, again, the output of the filter should be pure DC. If suppose still after using filter also, if we are unable to get the complete pure DC, there are some more little ripple content is present, then we have to use one more element called as a regulator. So that will completely eliminate the rest of the small amount of portion that is present out at the output of the filter. That means what, every block is not completely able to convert the AC to DC. So it is keep on decreasing the ripple content from block to block. After filters, you will be getting after rectifier, you will be getting the unidirectional. Then after filter, you will be getting the ripple content very, very small, but it is not again completely pure DC. So say there will be small fluctuations. Then after that, you have to use a regulator so that you will be getting a straight line. Okay, so that is the process. Practically, the filter circuit will try to minimize the ripple. Filter will definitely try to minimize the ripple, but it may not be exactly zero, or it will not be producing the pure DC. Some portion of the content will be there that will be eliminated by the regulator. So ideally, it should be pure DC, but practically, it will try to minimize the ripple at the output as far as possible. Basically, the ripple is nothing but what? AC. And that is varying with time. The thing whichever varies with time is AC, and the DC is a constant with respect to time. So we want a DC in the output. Suppose if you are getting something like this, T is there, here some voltage is there, output voltage or output current. Okay, now if you are getting some ripples, ripple like this, is it is not a straight line, right? Some variation with time is there. So the small amount of ripple will be there. If you see the height of this waveform, the small amount of ripple will be there. If you convert it into pure DC, then you should get a straight line which is parallel to the time. So after filter, you will be getting the waveform like this. After regulator, you will be getting the waveform like this. So that means actually the output of the rectifier will be like this. So this is output of the rectifier. This is the output of the filter. If you compare, the variation of this waveform with respect to time is more. Complete sine waveform it is. But if you see here, this is very small. Small ripples are there. Now after the regulator, you will be getting a straight line, which is pure DC. Okay, this is pure DC. So this is what is the purpose. So rectifier will be actually the input. Actually, your input is what? Full sine waveform. This is pure AC. AC is converted into this one by using a rectifier. By using a filter, you will get like this. By using a regulator, you will get like this. So step by step, we will be converting the entire AC into the DC. So that is what is the purpose. So now filter is what? Filter will eliminate or minimize the ripple content present in the output of the rectifier. Now, in order to separate DC from ripple, the filter circuit should use components which have widely different impedances for AC and DC. Okay. Now, two such components are inductance and capacitance. Now, what are the filter components? In filter, what elements we will use so that the AC is removed? By using inductances and capacitances, we can eliminate the ripple content present in the filter. So why? Because this inductance and capacitances, the impedances are keep changing for AC and DC. Okay, so therefore these are depends on the frequency. These are reactive components. We call these elements inductance and capacitances are reactive components. Okay, reactive components means which are dependent on the frequency. Suppose if you take the inductive reactance LXL, that is nothing but omega L, that is nothing but 2 pi FL. So it is depending on the frequency. Okay. So for DC signal, what is the frequency F is equal to? Tell me what is the frequency of DC signal. Type it in the chat box. What is the frequency of a DC signal? Very, very important, basic, fundamental, BWE. You might have learned, or in general, you will be knowing. What is the frequency of a DC signal? Type it in the chat box. Very, very important thing this is. What is the frequency of a DC signal? If you know, you write down the answer. If you don't know, you just type no. Then I'll tell the answer, not an issue. If you know the answer, type the answer. If you don't know the answer also, you have to give some indication stating that you don't know by typing the word no. Zero. Very correct. Exactly. 495. The credit goes to the first one who types it, because others may be knowing or may not be knowing, but whoever gives the first answer, they will be getting the credit. So 495 is zero heads, correct. So the DC signal will not have any frequency. It is zero. Okay. Then AC will be having, AC is having frequency, anything above zero. Okay, anything above zero, we can call it as say F is equal to infinity. Anything is above zero. Okay, if it is not equal to zero, I have to say. Okay, F is not equal to zero. Now, AC, XL is equal to omega L is equal to 2 pi FL. Okay. Now here, for DC, what happens this in this inductor, for DC, the XL value is, DC is nothing but you substitute F is equal to zero. XL value is zero. For AC, XL value is not zero. You can make even F is equal to infinity if you write F XL is equal to infinity. So what happens for DC XL is equal to zero, zero nothing but what is the impedance or reactance of the inductor is zero. What does it mean? It is short circuit. Okay. For AC, XL is equal to infinity, nothing but open circuit. So that's what is there in this table. So inductor for AC, it is open circuit. For DC, it acts like a short circuit. Okay. So the reactance of the inductor for DC is zero. For AC, it is not zero, or some inductor reactance will be there depending upon the frequency. But I am taking ideal value to be F is equal to infinity and XL will be also infinity. Okay, that is open circuit. Now, when this for DC is short circuit and for AC it is open circuit. Now I want to connect this inductor. This is the rectifier block. Okay, so the rectifier is this one. Output of the rectifier is DC plus AC. Already you know, output of the rectifier is DC plus AC. Now I want to connect the filter here. This is filter. Now, after the filter, there will be a load resistance, RL. So, filter is inserted between the rectifier and load. Now, after the filter, what is that I want actually? I want only DC, but AC completely should be eliminated to the as far as possible. I can't say that it will make a zero, but it should be as far as possible. This is ideal expectation. Ideal expectation is filter input is DC plus AC, filter output should be DC. What is this filter doing? Filter is completely removing or eliminating, suppressing the AC. So to suppress the AC, suppose here filter, I want to use an inductor. How do I connect the filter, the inductor in the filter? If you take the inductor behavior, for AC, it acts like an open circuit. For DC, it acts like a short circuit. So you assume that this inductor is a switch now. Now the switch is there. This is a switch. Inductor, actually, this is an inductor. Okay, inductor, but I'm assuming that it's acting like a switch. Now, this side, it is AC plus DC is flowing. See. Now, this switch, for AC, what happens? For DC, what happens? Switch AC is coming. In this combination of AC plus DC, I'm telling that AC is coming like this. Now, for AC, what happens? It is open circuit, open. For AC, it is open, nothing but what? AC will not pass through this. For AC, it is open. Will the AC come here if it is open? No. So for DC, it is short circuit. For DC, it is short circuit, nothing but short. Short, nothing but this will be closed. So it will come like this. Now, what happens? The DC passes here. So DC is coming. AC, it is open, zero. Plus, for DC, it is short, therefore coming. So that means what? We have to connect this inductor in series between your rectifier is there, your load is there. So in between the rectifier and load, inductor should be connected in series. So therefore, this is a filter circuit. I have to remove this filter circuit. Now I have to connect that with I have to connect an inductor in series. Now this portion, this particular circuit, we call it as a filter. Okay. Now what type of filter I am using here? The element is inductor. So therefore this filter, we can call it as inductor filter. Okay. Inductor filter. Now how this inductor is connected between the rectifier and the load, how it is connected in series? It is connected in series. That's why this is also called as series inductor filter. Series inductor filter. Okay. The filter name is series inductor filter. Now, next element, we will take it as capacitance. So, if you take inductance as an element, then we have to connect the inductance in the series between rectifier and filter so that that will eliminate the AC present in the output of the rectifier and it will pass only DC. Therefore, inductor should be connected in series. That's why it is called a series inductor filter. Okay. Next, if I use capacitor, then how I can use the how this capacitor will actually the eliminating the AC content, and how I have to connect it in the circuit, that we have to analyze now. So what I can do is now I will take the circuit diagram. I will take the reactance of the capacitor now. Okay. Reactance of the capacitor. What is the reactance of the capacitor? Xc is equal to 1 by omega c. That is equal to 1 by 2 pi fc. Now, for DC, what happens? Tell me. Here now it is denominator. F is in the denominator. For DC, F is equal to 0. Something divided by 0. 1 by 0. Xc will be infinity. So, infinity means open circuit. For AC, what happens here? Xc is equal to 0. That is short circuit. It is the opposite to the behavior of the inductor. Inductor for DC is short circuit, AC is open circuit. Capacitor, because it is reciprocal relationship between the frequency and reactance, the DC it acts like open circuit, AC it acts like a short circuit. If you see capacitor, AC is short circuit, DC is open circuit. Now the behavior of inductor and capacitor are opposite. Now when the inductor we have taken, we are connecting that in series. So that the DC plus AC is there, then only AC is eliminated and the other thing is passed through that, because that is acting as a short circuit for DC, open circuit for AC. Therefore, at the output, you will be getting only DC, AC is completely stopped there because it is open circuit. It is acting like a high impedance for AC. Now, the behavior is different. Now, if I connect the same capacitor in short, what happens in series? If you take the capacitor, again, you are having DC plus AC here as input. Now, what is that you will get here at the output? This capacitor acts like a, for DC, what happens? Open circuit. DC open circuit, nothing but you will not get DC. 0 you will get here. For DC, it is open. So, when DC is passing, open means you will get 0. For AC, it is short. Nothing but what? AC will be appearing. So, if you are passing DC plus AC through a capacitor, you are getting AC at the output. Is it required AC at the output or DC is required? You require DC, not AC. So, if you connect the capacitor in the series between the rectifier and load, instead of getting DC, you will be getting AC. So, that connection is wrong connection. So, capacitor cannot be connected in series between rectifier and load. Whereas inductor has to be connected in series between inductor and load. Now, how we can connect then if it is not in series? Now, this AC completely, which is passing through the capacitor, it should go to the ground and become nullified. And DC it has to come. Then what I can do? I can put that capacitor in the short, in the parallel, so that the short circuit will make the AC. Now, here AC, DC plus AC is coming. Now, it flows like this. It has got two paths now. One path is this side, the other path is this side. This is what is your actual output. Okay, output here is what? What is expected here? DC is expected in the output. So, now this is short, this is AC plus DC is coming. Now, this is open circuit, suppose. This is open. For what it is open? Open is for DC. So, for DC, when DC is coming like this. This is open. Okay, this is open. It is not closed. Open. So, if it is open, then entire DC will go in the straight line. This will become zero. This side, it will be zero. When DC is there, it is acting like an open. Therefore, the DC will not go this side. Zero will go that side. The entire DC will come this side. Now, AC is there. AC is passing. For AC, what is this behavior of the capacitor? It is short circuit. So, this will become short circuit, AC. Then entire AC will go this side, when 0 will go this side, plus 0. That means AC is passed through the capacitor into the ground and it will become 0. And output you will not be able to get the AC part. Whereas DC, when it is DC is there, DC this capacitor will act as open circuit and entire DC goes in the straight line towards the output. Okay, without taking a diversion into the capacitor. AC, because AC, the capacitor is short circuited, all the AC will go into the ground through the short circuit path. Nothing will go into the load resistance at the connected at the output. So, therefore, the capacitor should be connected in parallel because of its behavior for AC and DC. Capacitor is to be connected in parallel between the rectifier and the load. Then how you will be connecting that here? Instead of, now I will remove the inductor. I will just make the capacitor in the parallel. So this is we call this filter. Now if you use a capacitor which is parallel between the input and between the rectifier and the load, then we call this as a capacitor filter or shunt capacitor filter. Shunt, parallel, other name for parallel is shunt. Shunt capacitor filter. Okay, so we will be using inductor or capacitor in the filter circuits. Now, any one of them we can use or both of them we can use. If you use only inductor, then we call it as a series inductor filter, and that inductor should be connected in series between the rectifier and filter, rectifier and the load. Now, if I'm using only capacitor, the capacitor is should be connected in parallel between rectifier and load. Therefore, it is called shunt capacitor filter. Now, if you want to use the combination of both inductor and capacitor, if you use, then it is almost like a double filter. Okay, if you use only one element, one filter. If you use both the elements, it is like almost inductor is one filter, then followed by a capacitor will be there. That is another filter. So it is like if you use both combinations, then more amount of filter. It is like a double filter. Okay, so more amount of AC will be completely reduced. Therefore, you will be getting more ripple factor. So like that, based upon all these things, you have got the classification of the filters like this. A filter is an electronic circuit or electric circuit, whatever it may be, composed of a capacitor, inductor, or combination of both also can be used, and connected between rectifier and load to convert. What is the purpose of converting this? Pulsating DC to pure DC. Rectifier converts AC to pulsating DC. Now that pulsating DC again to convert into pure DC, filter is required. So very, very important definition of the filter it is. Complete information is given in this statement. Filter is an electronic circuit composed of capacitor, inductor, or combination of both, and connected between the rectifier and load to convert pulsating DC to pure DC. Pulsating DC where you are getting output of the rectifier. So that pulsating DC, we have to convert it into pure DC across the load. Therefore, filter circuit is used. Now, different types of filters are series inductor filter. Okay, series inductor filter means I will be connecting between the rectifier and the load like this. This side it is rectifier. This side it is load. This side it is rectifier. In between, we have to connect like this. Now, for shunt capacitor filter, we will be connecting the capacitor like this. For LC or L section filter, third one, LC or L section filter, we connect both combinations. Both combination means an inductor and a capacitor. Both will be there. Inductor will be there, capacitor will be there. Then that we call it as L section filter. It is like L shape, right? Inverted L shape. This is L shape. Inverted L shape. So still we call it as L section only. L section filter or LC filter. Next, CLC or pi section. CLC means first I'll connect a capacitor, then an inductor, then again a capacitor. This is CLC filter. CLC. So CLC filter, this is taking the shape of the pi. Is it not shape of the pi? Therefore, it's called pi section filter. This is shape of the L, inverted L, L section filter. So this is connected in shunt, parallel between the rectifier and load. Therefore, it is called shunt capacitor filter. This is connected between series. In series, it is connected between the rectifier and load. Therefore, it is called series inductor filter. So total, there are four types of filters are there. Series inductor filter, shunt capacitor filter, L section filter, pi section filter. Okay, so either inductor or capacitor or combination of both in the fashion of L type or in the fashion of pi type. So all these are the four different types of filters that we use. What is the purpose of filter? Purpose of filter is to convert pulsating DC to pure DC by eliminating AC content present in the output of the rectifier. by eliminating the ripple content, by minimizing the ripple content. Okay, so that is about this one. Now in the syllabus we have got the shunt capacitor filter that we'll see in detail about the shunt capacitor filter. Okay, now for half wave rectifier we apply this capacitor filter, and for full wave rectifier we apply this capacitor filter, and we'll see the operation. Now you already know it is a transformer, then a rectifier, and then between rectifier and load, this is the load, you will be connecting a filter. So this is filter, capacitor is a filter, this is a rectifier. Okay, this is the load, this is the transformer, this is your AC input. Okay, now what happens after this rectifier, what will be the output? You already know the dotted line in this waveform shows the output of the rectifier, which is acting like the input to the filter. Okay, now we will see if the input to the filter is the output of the rectifier, then out what will be the output of the filter. Okay, here what is that you have got? The positive half cycle is there, right? The negative half cycle is zero, again positive half cycle, then negative half cycle, zero, and so on. That is the what is the output of the half wave rectifier. Now for positive half cycles, what happens to the output of the capacitor, and so on, we'll see the operation. Very, very important. During the positive quarter cycle, positive quarter cycle, nothing but what? Positive quarter cycle means, if you see, this is the time omega t, we can take this is what is the input, or the input to the filter is nothing but output of the rectifier. So you will be getting the input to the filter is half wave. Half wave is like this. Then next, up to this is 0 to pi. From pi to 2 pi, it is 0. From 2 pi to 3 pi, again, you will be having something like this. Okay, this is what is the input. Now, for the positive quarter cycle, quarter nothing but what? This is actually half. Completely is half. 0 to pi is half. 0 to pi by 4 is quarter of the entire cycle. 0 to 2 pi is full cycle. 0 to pi is half cycle. 0 to pi by 2 is quarter cycle. So for the positive quarter cycle means 0 to pi by 2. 0 to pi by 2. The diode D is forward biased. Yes, diode D is forward biased because it is going in the positive direction. So 0 to this maximum value here is Vm. Maximum value is 0 to Vm. It is positive voltage, right? 0 to Vm is positive voltage. When positive voltage is connected to the anode of the diode is forward biased. Now, what happens? The diode is forward biased, nothing but what? It is short circuit, right? Short. Then after this diode, what is there? Capacitor is connected. Capacitor is there parallel to the ground, connected from the cathode of the diode to the ground. Now, this quickly charges the capacitor C to its peak value. Okay. So, capacitor C is there. So, because this is short circuit, whatever this V 0 to Vm is there, that 0 to Vm keeps on charging into the capacitor C. To the peak value. What is its peak value? Vm. Peak value is Vm. Of the input voltage, that is Vm. Practically, it will be Vm minus V gamma. Practical diode, if you take 0.7 is the cut-in voltage, Vm minus 0.7 will be the peak value. If you take ideal diode, then it will be Vm. If you take practical diode, it is Vm minus V gamma. V gamma is nothing but 0.7 for silicon, 0.3 for germanium. Now, when this diode is short-circuited, if this waveform is like this, if the waveform is like this, full sine waveform, output of the rectifier will be half sine waveform. Then during this quarter cycle, this capacitor gets charged to the maximum value of Vm. So capacitor is charging. See, like this. So capacitor gets charged to the maximum value of the Vm. So if you draw the waveform here, so the dotted line is the output of the rectifier or input to the filter. The thick line, I will be just overlapping on the same graph, both input and output. Okay, here input will be there, output also, output of the filter and input of the filter. So dotted line is input, output also will be, it is capacitor is getting charged. So output voltage across the capacitor will be like this, up to Vm. Okay, now after that, the input is decreasing. Now capacitor is having Vm. Now this is the diode. Now the input side, this is anode. The input side, the waveform is coming down from Vm to VM to this one, next quarter cycle. Next quarter cycle is this portion. Sine waveform is actually like this, right? So this portion is over already. Now I am thinking about this portion. Now already this is at this point, VM. Here it is VM. Now here it is less than VM because it is coming down this side. It is coming down this side. So the capacitor voltage is VM and the input anode side, the voltage is going less than VM because the next quarter cycle is falling down. Therefore, the capacitor is charged at VM at cathode. But that anode, the capacitor, the anode, the input voltage is decreasing from VM in the next quarter cycle. So what happens? Anode voltage is less than the cathode voltage. What happens to the diode D? It is reverse biased. When this is reverse biased, it is open circuit. So when this input is going in the downward direction from pi by 2 to pi, the diode is reverse biased. If the diode is reverse biased, this diode will be open. This diode is open. So the diode is open. The diode is open like this. Now what happens? This capacitor is already having VM, right? VM. Now this capacitor starts discharging because there is a load resistor available. This entire thing is connected to ground. Load resistor is there. This is the capacitor. Capacitor is already charged to VM. Now when the input is going below VM, this is reverse biased open circuit. Now capacitor, what happens, already charged to VM, it is finding now a path to discharge between across this through this resistor RL. So this VM also starts decreasing as long as this diode is reverse biased. So because there exists a discharging path. So this portion we call it as charging. Capacitor is charged to maximum value. Then next what happens, it discharges. Discharges nothing but it will be falling straight line like this and it keeps discharging. Okay. When it starts discharging, it completes the remaining, the input as completing is simultaneously the cycle, remaining cycle. And it when it comes to this level, by that time the input comes and again joins here. So by the time the input takes the entire cycle from here to pi by 2 to pi and from pi to 2 pi and from 2 pi to again this particular point, by that time this comes here and the input also joins here now. Now input here, again going beyond that, capacitor is value is now this much, and the input is again increasing beyond this. Now the diode again becomes short circuit, forward biased. Then again the capacitor charges to the maximum value. So in this portion from pi by 2 to so much here, this portion, this is this portion, we call it as a discharging time period, and in this case, it is D is off. Okay, D is off. Now, when it reaches this point, up to here, it is D is off. When it reaches this point from here to here, again, D is on up to here. After that, again, it repeats the same thing. D will be off and so on. Okay, so this portion of the waveform from here to here, this portion of the waveform, diode is on. This portion of the waveform from here to here, diode is off. So during off time, the capacitor discharges, and during the diode on time, the capacitor is charging. And if you see the steady state value, you will be getting this portion of the waveform is on and the remaining portion of the waveform is off. So this is diode is off, T1. T1 is nothing but discharge. T2 is nothing but charging. Okay, charge, discharging. So charging interval is very, very small, T2. Discharging interval is very large, T1. So diode is on only for small portion of the time period. Therefore, so you will be getting a current flowing in the diode, which we call it as a surge current. Okay, so the current that flows in the diode for the short period of time, when the diode is on, we call that current is called as surge current. Okay, surge current. So the surge current that is flowing in the diode for short period of the time, we will be representing that with a current pulse. So like this, current pulse. So that we call it as a surge current. and remaining portion the current will be zero, and the capacitor gets discharged. Then again after that, when it is diode is on, again you will be getting a current that is flowing in the diode. So that current pulse we can represent like this. It is almost like a square wave pulse. Okay, so this current we call it as a surge current, represented by I surge. This everything is happening at the interval T2. The remaining portion of the time period is T1. So T1 is discharging time period, T2 is charging time period. T2 time period diode is on, T1 time period diode is off. T1 time period diode is off means capacitor discharges through the resistor RL, and the discharging time constant of that capacitor is tau is equal to RL into C. So this time period tau is equal to RL into C, values of RL and C will decide the shape of this waveform, how much fast it is doing or how much more slow it will be doing and all those things. And T2 is the on period during which the capacitor charges to its maximum value, and when it is getting charged, the current will be flowing in the diode. That current we call it as a surge current, denoted by I surge. Okay, and it repeats. So it is this T2 period is very, very small, right? Actually T2 period, it is a sine shape. The T1 period, it is just a straight line. Okay, but if you take very small segment of the sine waveform, here, suppose this portion, it is almost like a straight line. So this waveform now will be on time is this one, off time is this one, on time is this one, off time is this one. Is it not a triangular waveform? Though on time is not exactly triangular, but that is very, very short period. Short period or short segment of the time of sine waveform will be almost considered as a straight line. So the discharging will be definitely a straight line, but charging interval will be a sine shape, which is overlapping with the input waveform. But that T2 time period is very, very short, and the segment of that portion of the waveform will be almost treated as a straight line. Therefore, what will be the output waveform of the filter? You will be getting a triangular waveform. The rising of the triangular edge, we call it as the charging time interval, and the falling one we call it as a discharging time interval. And the output of the filter is looking like a triangular waveform, which is above the zero level. So above the zero level. So somewhere here it is there. So the average value of this one will be well above the zero level. Therefore, the DC is present in that waveform. Along with that, because of this variation, okay, amplitude is there from here to here. This amplitude is what is your ripple content, which is very, very small. DC is more, but the ripple content is very, very small. Okay, so that is what is the output of the rectifier with the filter. With filter, without filter is the dotted line. With filter is the blue color line. So without filter, dotted line is pulsating DC. This dotted line is what you mean, pulsating DC. Okay, this line, this is the triangular waveform, is almost like a DC with small ripple. Okay, small ripple is there. So to avoid that small ripple, again we have to use a regulator. Then we'll get a straight line. Okay, so next. Therefore, during the entire negative half cycle and some portion of the next positive half cycle, the capacitor discharges through the RL. In the next positive half cycle, when the input signal becomes more than the capacitor voltage, the diode becomes forward biased and the charges the capacitor back to VN. So the process continues every cycle. As this capacitor voltage and the input catches, and the input is going beyond capacitor voltage, charging takes place. When this capacitor voltage and the input voltage is decreasing beyond the capacitor voltage, then it discharges. So charging and discharging takes place between the anode and cathode amplitudes comparison. So anode amplitude and cathode amplitudes, these two are keep changing. So when this anode voltage is greater than the cathode voltage, charging takes place. When anode voltage is less than the cathode voltage, then the discharging takes place. So you have to see the time period T2 is charging, time period T1 is discharging. So almost the total time period will be approximately total time period T is equal to T1 plus T2, but T2 is very, very small compared with T1. then we can approximate total time period T is approximately equal to T1 only, because discharging time interval is very, very large than the charging time interval. Then if you calculate the expression for the ripple factor derivation, then we can take like this. Let T is the time period of the AC input voltage. T1 is the time for which the diode is non-conducting. When the diode is non-conducting, what happens? Discharging of the capacitor takes place. So this we call it as discharge time interval. When the diode is non-conducting means reverse biased. When the diode is reverse biased, capacitor discharges, therefore discharging time interval is T1. T2 is the time for which the diode is conducting. Diode is conducting is forward biased. So during that interval, the charging takes place. This is called charging time interval T2. Now, if you take the total time period, T is equal to T1 plus T2, but it is approximately equal to T1 because T1 is very, very large compared with T2. Charging time is very, very small compared with discharging time interval. Then we can approximate it as total time period T is equal to T1. Then let VR be the peak-to-peak value of the ripple voltage. Peak-to-peak value of the ripple voltage means, if you take this as T, this is the output voltage. Then if you take the waveform like this, triangular waveform, then this peak is there, right? This peak. So this entire height of this one. Okay, the height of this waveform, we call it as VR. Okay, so this is the peak, this is another peak. So peak to peak value of the triangular waveform, we call, or the entire amplitude of the triangular waveform, we'll call it as VR. VR be the peak to peak value of the ripple voltage. This voltage is a ripple voltage, right? Which is assumed to be triangular waveform. It is given by, for triangular waveform, if you do the calculation of RMS value, then you will get V dash RMS is called VR by 2 root 3. So the derivation of this one is not required. We can directly remember the formula and use it here. Otherwise, in the BEE, RMS values you have calculated it, RMS average value. For the triangular waveform, you might have calculated the RMS value as VR by 2 root 3. Okay. So V dash RMS is equal to VR by 2 root 3 is the formula for RMS value of the triangular waveform. That is the RMS value of the triangular waveform. Where VR is peak to peak value. So peak to peak value. Actually, if you take only peak value, then you will be getting V dash RMS is equal to Vm by root 3. Okay. So Vm by root 3. Then peak to peak value, if you take it, is it will be VR by 2 root 3. Peak to peak value is VR is peak to peak value. So VR by 2 root 3 we will get. Okay. So next. Then what is that we can write here is, during the time interval T1, the capacitor C discharges. T1 is the discharging time interval through the load resistor RL. Okay. Therefore, the charge lost is Q is equal to C into VR. So charge lost during that discharging time interval is Q is equal to C into VR, and current can be written as I is equal to dQ by dt. That is nothing but Q is equal to integral 0 to T I dt. Then we will get that as I dc into T. Integral I dt will be I. Then if you substitute I is the constant which is DC current, I DC, integral 1 dt will be T, upper limit and lower limit if you substitute T minus 0 will be capital T. Okay, so I is the constant, DC current or average current, I DC into T. So I is equal to I DC into T, Q is equal to C into VR. I is equal to dQ by dt, Q is equal to I DC into T. So two relationships are there. So Q is equal to CVR is there, Q is equal to IDC into T are there. Both are equal. 192 you can equate. 192 you can equate. That is C into VR and IDC into T. Both are charges only. So the charge is in terms of capacitor and voltage, and the other equation is charge in terms of current and time. Now equating these two, you will get it as IDC into T is equal to C into VR. IDC into T is equal to C into VR. Then VR can be written as IDC T by C. Okay, now you know the ripple factor formula. Ripple factor formula is gamma is equal to V dash RMS by VDC. V dash RMS by VDC. That is equal to V dash RMS already we know VR by 2 root 3. So VR by 2 root 3 into VDC. Now VDC is VDC is nothing but what this VR is nothing but what IDC into T by C. The same thing you substitute that here. VDC VR is equal to IDC T by C. IDC T by C. Denominator 2 root 3 into VDC as it is. Now IDC by VDC can be written as 1 by RL. So this T can be written as 1 by F. So these all are since T is equal to 1 by F. T in place of T we substituted 1 by F. And in place of IDC by VDC, IDC by VDC, we have substituted 1 by RL. Okay. So IDC by VDC substituted 1 by RL. Ohm's law. It is simply Ohm's law. VDC is called IDC into RL. Okay. Then you will be getting the final formula as gamma is equal to 1 by 2 root 3 into FC RL. That means the ripple factor depends on the frequency, the capacitor value and the resistor value. So you have to suitably choose these values of capacitor and resistor, load resistor, such that your ripple factor will be as small as possible. Okay, that is what is the final expression. Okay, now this charging time, whatever the charge that is getting charged into the capacitor is equal to the same amount of charge that is lost in the capacitor during discharging phase. So that is nothing but we can write it like Q discharge, whatever the charge that is getting discharged through the capacitor, okay, Q discharge is should be same as the Q charge. So charging interval is actually T1, charging interval is actually T1 and discharging interval is actually T2. But discharging interval T2, whatever that we have taken will be the complete time period T. So discharging is nothing but discharging time interval is very large than charging time interval. Therefore, what we have assumed here T1 or T2 for discharging and charging. Discharging is T1, charging is T2. Okay, charging is T2, discharging is T1. So what I can write here is the discharging time, discharging charge will be IDC into capital T, that is equal to charging will be during charging interval surge current will be flowing. The current here we will take it as I surge. Okay, and the time period during the discharging is T2 in this case. Here I have assumed it as T2. So this can be written as the I surge current can be written as I surge is equal to, okay, IDC into T by T. Okay, so this is also one important formula while solving the problems. You may be asked to calculate what is the surge current when the diode is conducting for a short period of time. How much is the surge current that is flowing in the diode? I surge is equal to IDC into T by T2. Okay, so this is another formula. So most important formula, these two are. So 1 by 2 root 3 into FCRL. Simply by taking Q here, in this case, you have taken just IDC T is equal to C into VR. VR is equal to IDC T by C. Okay. Then ripple factor definition is V dash RMS by VDC. We already know V dash RMS is equal to VR by 2 root 3. So that one you substituted here and VDC is already there as it is. Now in place of VR, you just bring this and IDC by VDC is 1 by RL, T is 1 by F. Just we have substituted everything, we got this expression. So that is the ripple factor expression for half wave rectifier. Similar analysis we can do it for full wave rectifier also. The difference is that for full wave rectifier, this is from 0 to pi, pi to 2 pi. Okay. Now, for half wave rectifier, you might be getting this waveform. Okay. For half wave rectifier, I'll draw with some other color. See. For half wave rectifier, you will be getting graph. Because this middle portion will be zero, right? For half wave rectifier, pi to 2 pi will not be there. So you will be getting graph like this.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, in half wave rectifier, capacitor is charged with the AC current only.
Capacitor?
is charged with AC one only. Yeah.
In capacitor. Yes, AC only.
Yes,
that's why, you know, it is following the input. Input sine waveform is there, right? The same sine wave shape only is taken when we are charging the capacitor. Is it okay? If you see this waveform.
Sir, means I touch means it is AC one only, sir.
Which one?
I surge
is only the diode current I am taking. Diode current is I surge. That means the small amount. No, IDC is nothing but the for the remaining the triangular waveform is the IDC. That is charge discharging time. Discharging time period is DC. I am comparing that in terms of I surge in terms of IDC. I surge is the current. Is the diode current that is flowing, even though this capacitor is, we are not taking across the capacitor, for the rectifier circuit only. For the rectifier circuit, the current that is flowing in the diode will be AC plus DC. Okay, I surge is during the charging period, right? Charging period, you will be having AC plus DC, both. So, I surge is different, IDC is different. IDC is during discharging time interval. During discharging time interval, the diode is off, and the capacitor is already charged to its peak value, and it is discharging through the resistor RL. So the discharging interval will be discharging interval period. The discharging will be taking place between the capacitor and the load resistor. So that discharging will be average value is taken. So IDC is average value of the discharging time interval, whereas I surge is the charging time interval. Charging time interval, the diode is on. That time, what is happening actually, it is having as DC as well as AC. So, we will be having this capacitor, while charging this capacitor, we will be having this entire signal, which is same as the input signal. So, that's why blue color line, if you see during the charging time period interval, blue color line is just following the input. Whereas this T1 period is just discharging time interval. Okay. So this time the diode is on, and that current that flowing in this on current, we call that as I surge. Okay. But when we are taking the discharging time interval, I am calculating that as IDC. So the charge here Q charge, here it is Q discharge. I am equating both of them. So when I am charging here, I will write it as I surge into its time period. So this QC here is I surge into that time period is T2. Okay. When the other portion of the time Q discharge will be IDC. IDC into total time period I am taking. Actually, it should be T1. But T1 plus T2, if you approximate, the entire one will be T only we can consider. So, this is T I am taking. That means when I am taking the DC, I will be taking the entire operation DC. But for when I am taking charging only, when the diode is on, that time only I am taking, which I call that as current that is flowing when the diode is on is surge current. So discharging I will be taking completely T1 plus T2. Okay, that because the T2 also has got the DC content present. So therefore, I will be writing discharging period as IDC into capital T. Charging period I will be writing it as I surge into T2. So that I want to calculate only the current that is flowing in the diode when that is on, which we call it as sir, a surge current. Okay. Yeah. Hello?
Sir, since only AC is passing through capacitor, it is charged with AC current only. No, sir.
When the diode is on, actually the capacitor is getting charged, right? The capacitor is getting charged.
Yes, sir.
That capacitor is charging to its maximum AC value, Vm. Is it okay? Vm is what? Maximum value of the input signal, right? So it is going to charge to the maximum value of the AC signal. So this is the way. So this is input is AC, output is also that charging capacitor getting charged is also AC. So when this reaches Vm, after that, what is happening? AC is actually going down, but this getting discharged because of the diode is off here. So it is getting discharged. So capacitor is getting charged to its maximum value of the input voltage. So capacitor, while charging, it is reaching to its maximum value through the diode. Okay, overall, if you see after this entire operation is over, overall, if you calculate, then you will be getting again the output of the capacitor filter also is AC plus DC only. But if you have to calculate again, what is the average value? Average value of this one will be, now this is the amplitude from here to here. What is the DC value across the capacitor means? You have to calculate the average value, which will be exactly middle of this one. So this much is the DC present and this much is the AC present. So across the capacitor filter also, we are getting AC plus DC. But DC is more, AC is very little. That is the difference between the rectifier output and the filter output. So rectifier output, we will be having more AC content. But after the capacitor, you will be shifting this entire waveform above the ground level. So this triangular waveform is appearing above the ground level. So how much of the DC will be there means the triangular waveform will be there, right? Triangular waveform, average of the triangular waveform, if you see, you may be getting somewhere middle of the middle of the triangular waveform. From there, if you calculate up to zero level, so this particular level, this line, the red color line is your DC level, or average value of this triangular waveform, and this is what is your DC voltage. So this may be, say, 5 volts, okay? And above this and below this may be 5.5, and the bottom one may be 4.5, suppose. That means the amplitude of AC is how much here? 1 volt. AC amplitude peak to peak is 1 volt. DC value is 5 volts. And the peak to peak value of this triangular waveform is 1 volt. That means what? Again, your filter output is having AC plus DC. But AC is how much? 1 volt. DC is how much? 5 volts. So AC content is very small. DC content is very large. Okay. So by seeing the waveform, we can tell that output of the capacitor filter is having again AC plus DC, but AC is very, very small. If you calculate the ripple voltage here, ripple factor here, gamma is equal to AC content divided by DC content means 1 by 5. Okay, 1 by 5 is what is your gamma value. I hope you are understanding. Hello?
Sir.
Are you understanding? This triangular waveform is above the ground level, and average value of the triangular waveform, you have to take it, and that level is 5 volts level, and above 5 volts, zero, it is 5 volts, right? That is what is DC, 5 volts. And the triangular waveform is, average of the triangular waveform is 5, that is exactly middle level, and above 5, we have got some amplitude in the positive direction, 5.5, below that is 4.5. Then the entire AC value is how we can calculate AC amplitude. 5.5 minus 4.5 is 1 volt. 1 volt is AC. And this 5 volts is DC. Then ripple factor will be gamma is equal to AC divided by DC in the output. Therefore, 1 divided by 5 is what is your ripple factor. So this has got a low ripple than low ripple compared with the output of the rectifier. So now in this process, what you are saying is charging and discharging taking place, right? So we will calculate the average value once entire charging discharging intervals are over. Okay, for entire value of the output voltage, we calculate. So in the process of charging and discharging, so some portion of the AC also is getting charged into the capacitor. That's what is charging time interval. When it is discharging also is AC. Okay. We'll calculate the average of this entire charging and discharging intervals, then only we will be able to tell how much DC is present. So we cannot exactly tell that the DC only is getting charged or DC only is getting discharged. No, we cannot say, because it all depends on the time. So the waveform you are getting is charging will be there, which is time varying. Discharging is there, which is time varying. It is varying with time. Charging and discharging time varying. Time varying is nothing but what? AC only. So when you will calculate DC out of that AC and AC plus DC, only if you take the average value of that one. Okay. Even for sine waveform also, if you take sine waveform of this one, so it is varying with time. Here also varying with time. What is the average value? The exactly middle. Suppose if you take a sine waveform, which is taking in the positive direction, it is starting from here, suppose. This is the sine waveform. This is 0. This is 5. This is 10. What do you call this? Is it AC or DC? I can say that it is AC plus DC, because it is above the ground level. Ground is here. So what is its average value means exactly in the middle, which is 5 volts. So this waveform is having 5 volts of DC plus peak to peak value is how much? This is maybe Vm, this is Vm, Vm sin omega t. Okay, this is having DC above the ground level. So similarly, this triangular waveform also, while charging and discharging, we cannot say whether it is AC is charging or DC is discharging or AC, DC is charging or AC is discharging. The charging and discharging will be AC only. So, but that will be above the ground level. We can calculate only once all the output is waveform is obtained and by taking the average of that. Okay. So that is what is the thing. So while charging, it is charging AC into the capacitor, and that current that is flowing in the current in the diode will be the subject current. And while discharging, we call the current as we'll take the current as a DC current. DC current we are taking completely for charging as well as discharging, but charging time interval is very, very small. Therefore, I have written it as T is equal to T only, not T1. Otherwise, you might have written here T1. Okay, IDC T1 is equal to I surge into T2. Actually, discharging time interval is only T1, right? Charging time interval is T2. But I have written in place of T1, you can write as it is, you can even call this as T1, but later you can approximate T is equal to T1 plus T2. Okay. So when I'm writing T is equal to T1 plus T2, T1 is very, very large compared with T2. T2 can be ignored and we can write T as T1 as T only. So then we can write that. Otherwise, the accurate one is IDC T1 is equal to I surge into T2. Okay. So that is the formula. I hope you understood. So charging charging is exactly same as the input. Output is same as input, sine waveform only. Discharging, you will get a linearly decaying function and it will again catch with the charging interval, again with the sine waveform. Discharging interval is a linearly decaying function. Charging will be again catching the sine waveform. So the shape of the waveform will be sine, then straight line, sine, then straight line. But what I'm taking is this portion of the waveform is very, very narrow. So any sine waveform, a small segment will be almost looking like a straight line. That's why I'm assuming the output of the waveform as a triangular waveform. It is just an assumption because the segment of the time period for which the discharge charging takes place is very, very small. That segment of the portion, we can almost treat it like a straight line. Therefore, I am taking this assumption that the waveform that you are getting at the output of the filter is a triangular waveform, but it is not exactly a triangular waveform. The discharging is a sine waveform. The charging is a sine waveform, discharging is a straight line. Okay, so this is just an assumption to calculate the expression for the ripple factor. Okay, that's what we have done V gamma be the peak to peak value of the ripple voltage, which is assumed to be triangular waveform. It is not exactly a triangular waveform, right? But it is a sine waveform in the charging interval and a straight line in the discharging interval, and so on. It repeats. But assumed it has to be a triangular waveform, and we have taken the V dash RMS for the triangular waveform as VR by 2 root 3, and I proceeded with the rest of the derivation. Okay, that is the thing. The same procedure we follow it for the full wave rectifier also. Full wave rectifier, what is the red color line is indicating half wave rectifier, and blue color line is indicating the full wave rectifier. If you see the time period from here to here is capital T. Now from here to here, if you see, and here to here, if you see, it is twice. Okay, so almost if you compare the time period of the half wave rectifier and time period of the full wave rectifier, it is almost half. This is T by 2, this is T by 2. Okay, time period T is for half wave rectifier, and time period for full wave rectifier will be T by 2. If the time period is T by 2, what happens to frequency? If time period is half, full wave rectifier time period is half of that of half wave rectifier time period, then what will be the frequency? If frequency time period makes half, what happens to frequency? Can someone tell? If time period is made half, what happens to the frequency?
Double.
Time period is equal to 1 by f. So time period is 1 by f. If time period is half, then your frequency will be double. So what will be the formula here? Already we got the formula for the ripple factor of the half wave rectifier is gamma is equal to 1 by 2 root 3 FCRL. This F value is double. Then in place of F, if you keep 2F, then what happens? It will become 4 root 3 FCRL. So everywhere you have to take it as, this one you can take it as T by 2. Wherever T is there, T by 2 you can take. T by 2. Okay. So here T by 2, here T by 2, then it will become 4F. The same is the derivation. So I will be taking the entire time period as T by 2 is equal to T1 plus T2. Okay, T by 2. Then here it is T by 2. Here the limits are also T by 2. Then here T by 2. Then answer you will get it as 1 by 4 root 3 FCRL. Everything else is the same. Only is that the charging and discharging time intervals will be just made half. Okay. Operation will be again same. You can see the operation. 0 to pi by 2. Diode D is forward biased. Capacitor C gets charged through the forward bias diode to the peak value of Vm. Okay. So during the positive half cycle from the 0 to pi by 2, the capacitor gets charged to Vm value. This is Vm value. Now from pi by 2 to, this is 0 to pi by 2. From pi by 2 to pi is there. Again from pi to 2 pi is there. Now from pi by 2 to pi, the capacitor starts discharging through the RL because the diode D1 gets reverse biased. Now the capacitor is getting discharged. Now, as long to up to what extent it discharges, just we'll start from pi to 2 pi, it is getting discharged. So this is pi, say it is getting discharged. Now, so the capacitor C supplies the load current. Now, pi to 3 pi, if the input voltage exceeds the capacitor voltage, making D2 forward biased. So that means up to, again, the next cycle has to come right. The next cycle will be coming like this. The rectifier output, full wave rectifier output from pi to 2 pi. Now this will discharge to the point up to which the input voltage starts rising. After this only the input starts rising, right? Then again the capacitor charges to this level. Then after that actually the input is going down, the capacitor discharges. When it again catches, when this next cycle starts coming, up to that, after that it charges. That means initially you will be getting the waveform like this, but after that it will be only, this is all is what is called a steady state. Steady state, this is what is initial. Initially it happens here, but if you see from the portion from here to here only, some portion from here to here, it is discharging, charging, then discharging. Then you will be observing almost like a triangular waveform. Okay, but initially it will be charging from 0 to Vm. Okay, but after that it will be discharging again, charging, then some small period of time, then discharging, then charging. This is steady state value, this is initial value, but we will be seeing the steady state value only. Therefore, that portion of the waveform will be a triangular waveform. Now, from pi by 2 to pi, pi to 3 pi by 2. In this pi to 3 pi by 2, in the middle somewhere, up to some portion it will be reverse biased. After that it will be forward biased from pi to 3 pi by 2. Okay, then from 3 pi by 2 to pi again it will be discharging completely. After that 2 pi also, some portion it will be discharging only. So then later it will be charging. So this has got again two portions. Some portion will be reverse biased, some portion will be forward biased. But this is very clear. This is completely forward biased initially. But this initially also is not exactly 0 to pi by 2. The steady state value will be only some portion. So pi by 2 to pi is completely reverse bias only. From pi to 3 pi by 2, some portion is reverse biased, some portion is forward biased. From 3 pi by 2 to 2 pi is completely reverse biased and alternately. So alternately, it happens. So reverse biased some portion, forward biased some portion, then reverse biased, then next cycle will be reverse biased some portion, forward biased. That means majority of the portion will be reverse biased only. Only some period when the charging takes place, that period only it is forward biased. That short period of time the current is, the diode is forward biased. Therefore, large amount of current will suddenly flow, which we call it as surge current. Okay, surge current is, if you allow something to happen for short duration of time, there will be more intense current will be flowing. So that will be called it as a surge current. So, and the remaining portion, the current will not be there, zero, only discharging takes place through the load resistor RL. Therefore, slowly this this falls to the discharging level falls, and suddenly it catches and the current will be start flowing. So, therefore, that portion of the period where the current flows, we call it as a surge current. Okay. So, the same operation, derivation is also same. Finally, you will get the answer as 1 by 4 root 3 FC RL. So, half wave rectifier with shunt capacitor filter. Shunt capacitor filter is gamma is equal to 1 by 2 root 3 FC RL. And with full wave rectifier with shunt capacitor filter will be gamma is equal to, only the difference is 4 root 3 FC RL. The difference is in half wave rectifier time period is T. For full wave rectifier, the time period is T by 2. Half wave rectifier frequency is F. The full wave rectifier frequency is 2F. So frequency of the full wave rectifier is twice that of the frequency of the half wave rectifier. So it doubles. Frequency doubles. Time period is made half. So with that, the formulas will be changing like this. Okay. So that is all about the capacitor filter. So output of the capacitor filter is a triangular waveform with a small AC content. Small AC content means peak to peak value of that one will be very, very small. But the DC content will be more. That means the triangular waveform is well above the ground level. Well above the ground level. Okay. So that is what we will be able to get. So this is zero level. Then you will maybe getting the waveform somewhere here. And so on. So what is its average value means? We have to take the middle of this one. And this value may be 5 volts or 4 volts, whatever it may be. That is what it is, we call it as DC. And this amplitude, we call it as AC. That means output of the filter is also having AC plus DC. But AC is very small. DC may be large. Okay. This small portion of this one also we have to eliminate by using regulator. Then you will get only this one. That means if this triangular waveform is there, right? After using a regulator, the triangular waveform will become straight line, 5 volts. Okay, that also will be eliminated. So that is what is about the filters and regulators. And there are other different types of filters are there. The derivations of all those things are not required. Even these formulae are also not required, just for understanding purpose. Series inductor filter will be having the ripple factor like this. Shunt capacitor filter is this one. All these are calculated for full wave rectifier. Okay. So the LC filter will be connected like this. CLC filter is connected like this. Okay. So out of all these things, if you go, CLC filter will be the best one because it is having more sections of filter. See, capacitor filter is there, then inductor filter, then capacitor filter. Even we can have multiple L section filters also. Multiple L section filters, nothing but what? Now, suppose the ripple content is not sufficient. Still, if you want to reduce, then you can connect already one inductor and capacitor filter is there. Suppose this is L1, C1. Then one more you can put L2, C2 and so on. That means multiple L section filters also you can use to eliminate the more ripple to be reduced. Even multiple CLC filters also can be used. Multiple CLC filter means just cascading. Already one capacitor is there. CLC filter is there. Okay. C1, L1, C2. This can be read C2. Okay. And you can take one more section, but both the capacitors, you can make it is equivalent. Then you can make it like this also. Okay. This is again L2. This is C3 or so. Yeah, this one you can call C12, this is you can call C2 or so. So that means there are actually two parallel capacitors, but I made it equivalent to one capacitor. Otherwise, it is a multiple CLC filters only. Okay, so multiple L section filters, multiple CLC filters also, we can use any number of filter sections to eliminate the ripple content as far as possible. Okay, so finally, we require the desirable output should be DC. So to eliminate the EAC, all these things we can do. You can use any number of sections of filters to reduce that AC content. And finally, we will use a regulator so that any small ripple present in that filter output will be made it as a zero. and it will be just directly made it as a pure DC at the output of the regulator. Okay, so this is what is the purpose of the filters. So filters contains what components? Inductors and capacitors. So inductor always should be connected in series, capacitor should be always connected in parallel. And you can have a inductor filter or capacitor filter or L section filter or multiple L section filters, CLC filter or multiple CLC filters, and so on. Okay.